It's time we invest in New Mexico. In business, if you don't do things a different way, if you do things the same way every year, you will fail. So you always have to find a better way. You always have to evolve. What should be going up is going down. What should be going down is going up. Maybe those that are in should be going out. I'm not running because it's my turn. I'm running to turn around New Mexico. I was actually born and was raised in Las Cruces when my father became governor at age 12 and moved to Santa Fe. I'm really optimistic about the future. Having overcome cancer, I never gave up on myself. Our family motto is God, family, friends. We figured everything kind of works that way. Under a Jeff Apodaca administration, 225,000 new jobs, higher income, higher salaries, better opportunities for our kids. We're going to invest into technology. My father started year-round kindergarten. It's time this generation starts year-round preschool and also early family development. I'll never give up on New Mexico. I'm Jeff Apodaca, and I'm running for governor of the state of New Mexico.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next governor of New Mexico, Jeff Apodaca.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much. I appreciate everybody coming tonight. Thank you for coming. I apologize, it's a little warmer here. I might have to take my jacket off. But we're here tonight because we're tired of being 50th. We're here tonight because we're tired of being at the bottom of every good list and the top of every bad list. We're frustrated. So that's what our campaign's about, to turn New Mexico around. But before we start, let me talk you a little bit about myself. Jackie, please stand. This is my beautiful wife, Jackie. I think you guys are married. And we have two wonderful, wonderful kids, Asher and Gage. And I don't think some people realize, but I was actually born in Las Cruces. My mother, Clara. Clara, stand up, please. My mother, Clara, is actually, and my aunt, Esther, grew up in Doniana. And my dad grew up in Las Cruces. And people think my father was an attorney. My dad was actually a high school football coach. And I come from educators, from the agricultural community. And my father became a state senator in 1975. My father became governor, and we moved to Santa Fe. And I've always kind of said that I've had a kind of a perfect childhood where I got to know the South, but I grew up in the North. So I got to know New Mexico. But the number one question that was asked, what's it like to be the governor's kid? Well, to me, it was a big family. My parents had 5 kids in 7 years. So to me, it was just a big family. My father grew up in politics. It was just something we kind of grew up with. The residence, as we called it, was just our house. But there's two things I do remember most. Is when you have 5 kids in 7 years, our house was loud. I don't really remember a lot of one-on-one time or alone time with mom and dad. But when I was 12, I spent the summer campaigning with my father. And there's two things about it. It was the first time I really remember spending one-on-one time with my dad. But more importantly, it's the first time I got to know New Mexico. It's the first time I went to Español, to Taos, to Chama. It's the first time I went to the East Side. So I got to know what New Mexico is about. Our community, our state, my parents, our schools, my coaches prepared me for my opportunities. Our political leaders, our communities aren't doing that today. But as a normal kid, I just had dreams. In fact, my first job, Joe Friday's gas station, across the street from DeVarcus. Ronson and I hung out at the Boys Club in Santa Fe. I was just a normal kid, but I had dreams. Guess what my dream was? I was going to play football for the Dallas Cowboys. I was sure that's going to happen. And the reason I say that is growing up the governor's kid, this is me, my senior year, we won state, our championship year. And I was an all-state running back, getting recruited to play college football. So I knew I was on my way. But some people don't remember that halfway through my senior year, I got stricken with cancer. I was the 9th person in the world to ever have my type of cancer. And I went to MD Anderson, I was treated here. And the reason I tell you that is that I never gave up on my dream. Even when the doctors told me I was never going to play football again. Even when the doctors told me that all they're going to do is try and save your life. I never gave up on my dream. And I came back and played at the University of New Mexico, and this is me my senior year. I started my last year as a safety, and this is me making a tackle against Nebraska. And the reason I tell you that, it's about never giving up on our dreams, preparing for our opportunities that we are not doing for our children. My wife and I, my parents, we've always given back, even when we didn't live here. You know, Jackie's from Albuquerque, went to New Mexico State. Even that we didn't live here, we started the Jeff Apodaca Celebration Foundation to help cancer kids, to help teenagers here in the University of Mexico, here at UNM. And this is, we raised over $1.5 million and built the multimedia center out. We started a scholarship program. These are actually two of our nurses. But the reason I tell you that, it's about giving back. It's about turning New Mexico around. And those opportunities that I was prepared for took me to the business school. And I had 32 years in media, whether it's CBS, AOL, or Univision, I built successful businesses. What I can do for the state. So I'm not running for governor, because my dad was. I'm definitely not running for governor because Clara thought it was a good idea. And I'm not running for governor because I have to wait my turn. I'm running for governor to turn New Mexico around, but for the two biggest reasons, Asher and Gage. My success. And by the way, this is probably the last time they hugged each other. But my two sons represent the kids of New Mexico. My two sons represent the kids that we're not building their opportunities for. Let me tell you something kind of sad. So Jackie and I make sure we have one-on-one time with our children. So a few months ago, I was actually having Daddy Asher Day. Asher's the one on the right. And Asher literally turns to me and says, "Hey, Daddy, when you're governor, can you do me one favor? As a second grader, 9-year-old, I don't want any more homework. I want more art classes. You know what my son told me? Daddy, can you have my friends stop leaving the state of New Mexico?" My sons have lost 3 friends because their families have moved for better opportunities. It's sad to say that 9-year-olds know we've lost 150,000 jobs in our state. 9-year-olds know we're last. 9-year-olds know that opportunities aren't being prepared for our youth. And I see teachers shaking their heads because that's what's happening. So let's talk about where we've been, where we are, and where we can go. New Mexico, our economy, we're 400 years old. Our first economy was agriculture. We grew things. We do it today. In fact, we exported to France and Spain. In the early 1900s, we got into ranching and farming. And then we found copper, silver, oil and gas, coal. Those were our industries. But I want you to think about this. Starting in the 40s to today, nuclear, aerospace. We all know who that is, right? Bill Gates, the famous story of Albuquerque, how Microsoft moved. Computers, nanotechnology, 3D imaging, biotechnology. Folks, these are industries that are trillion-dollar economies. These are industries that have created hundreds and thousands of jobs. Every one of these was started right here in New Mexico. Every one of them have left. Why? Because we don't invest into ourselves. We don't invest into New Mexico. We don't build opportunities for our kids. And even in the 80s, we got into film and television. A $1 billion industry for our state. And this governor cut it away 8 years ago. Now we're slowly building it back, but opportunities. So where are we now? We know we're 50th in job creation. We're 50th in education. We have the highest unemployment in the country. I want you to look at this. 4.5% unemployment in 2008, when the economy was the worst economy since the recession. We've actually gotten worse in the last 8 years. We have the lowest household income at $45,000 compared to the rest of the country. Colorado is 66. Look at this. These are cities, Austin, Denver, Austin. These are cities that have exploded since they've come back. We've actually gone down. I want you to think about this. Every state, Illinois, Texas, West, 2.1, to 4.9% unemployment. We're at 6.7. Every state, 83 to 95% high school graduation rate. We're at 68. It's crazy. Now, are we unlucky? Or is it leadership? I think it's leadership. Our agriculture, our rural communities continue to struggle because of this. We're doing nothing to help them. And in fact, we talked about it earlier. 75% of the University of New Mexico graduates leave our state. A third of our kids leave our state. It's the first time this has happened. D.C. cannot solve our problems. Our political leaders cannot solve our problems in D.C. And I will defend anything Donald Trump tries to do. But the last time I looked at the United States of America, and we need to invest into ourselves. And maybe our congressional leadership needs to stay there and fight for New Mexico. Fight for what we need to do. Fight for our opportunities. That's what we need to do. We also don't want to be California, Arizona, New York. We're New Mexicans. We have strengths. We have opportunities. We just need the leadership and the courage and the will to invest in ourselves. So what if? What if we do something a better way? Now let me tell you. My wife calls me the what if guy. In fact, the other day she goes, there he is, that what if thing again. Right? In fact, I think the greatest creation, I'm a media guy. I think the greatest creation in television is the DVR. That's the thing that you play back and forth? You would hate to watch football with me. I go, Jackie, check this out. What if they did this? What if they did that? What if they did this? But the reason I say that is 32 years in business, I've been successful not because of me, because of my team. Guys, what if we do something better? What if we change our ways? That's how you build the economy. That's how you change things. So what if? What if we do something a little bit better? We have no funds. Our political leaders bicker over $30,000 to $40,000 when our budget's $6.2 billion. Our political leaders tell us we have no money. Well, let's talk about that. Colorado, $500 billion economy, six times larger than New Mexico. $550 million. Louisiana, Oregon, Alabama, North Dakota, $1.2 to $3.8 billion. Wyoming, a state very similar to us, oil and gas and agriculture, $5.4 billion. 6 months ago, Governor Jerry Brown in California, sixth largest economy in the world, he's literally high-fiving because California sits on $7.9 billion. Investment. $100 million fine. Highest unemployment. Poor state. We have no money. Folks, we sit on $21.6 billion and invest it all in Wall Street, all outside our state, and don't invest in ourselves. So what if? What if we invest into ourselves? Let me tell you something. Brazil. Australia. Last time I looked, that's a continent, right? Am I right? Continent? Mexico, Canada. These four countries and a continent combined, we have more money. And our political leaders say, hey, it's a rainy day fund. It's for our future. Folks, we're in the middle of a hurricane, and the roof just got blown. And we will not invest to repair our house, to repair our roof. So what if? What if we take 5% of our investments and invest it into ourselves? Invest it into our businesses, into our schools, into our community. What if? Guess what? We'd still have $20.5 billion. We'd still have the third largest permanent funds in the country, the 14th largest in the world. And guess what? We would still have the same interest that our political leaders take off to budget our state. So what if? What if we invest into ourselves and to the strengths that we haven't done for 60 years? So let's talk about how we're going to turn the economy around. Infrastructure. We have to start investing in our infrastructure, into our schools, the sequias, our arroyos, our agriculture. It's a must. Small business. technology businesses every day, small businesses, our veterans, arts and crafts. 95% of our economy is small business. We do nothing to invest in them to help them grow. In fact, you know what we do? We actually entice companies and offer them millions and billions of dollars to come here and to compete and put our New Mexico businesses out of business. So what if we invest into ourselves, into our New Mexico businesses? Now look, I'm not against, I'm a business guy, I am not against bringing outside companies in. We're gonna do that. But what we need to do is we need to invest into ourselves and grow our small businesses. That will explode our economy. And guess what, when we do that, companies will come and knock. Companies will come here. Companies will invest with us. Startups and technologies. We start companies all the time. Innovate ABQ, I'm on the board, it's literally blocks away. STC, University of New Mexico, literally started 12 companies last year out of their STC tech transfer. 10 left the state. Why? Because we don't invest in it. We don't invest in ourselves. Here's a crazy thing. We live in a state that's ranked second for renewable energy. But we're ranked 48th in renewable energy's production. That's crazy. So we're going to invest in renewable energies. Now look, I'm not worried about powering your house. It's gonna happen naturally. Clearly we've gotta worry about powering this building because it's a little warmer here. But we're gonna power California. We're gonna power Arizona, Nevada. We need to start thinking big. We need to start thinking outside the box. In today's market, there's $1 trillion of private capital that will invest with us in renewable energies. $1 trillion of long-term debt financing, looking to invest in it. In today's world, we can actually build a solar cluster field at 2 cents a kilowatt. Now, I have no idea what a kilowatt means. What I do know, though, is we can produce it at 2 cents. In California, buys it at 8 to 11 cents at wholesale. That's a 6 to 7 time return on our investment. There's not a business person in here that wouldn't take that deal. Oil and gas. Now everybody talks about oil and gas. Folks, it is 35% of our economy. It's New Mexico families. It's New Mexico businesses. We can't penalize them, but we can invest and work with them to do it better. To recapture methane. In fact, the big push right now is we're pushing, and they're looking at it, to basically recapture methane. It doesn't cost that much money, and we would make an extra hundreds of millions of dollars on recapture. It just makes sense. Biotechnologies, we talk about. We know this, I think, I hope this room knows this. University of New Mexico, Sandia, our medical schools. It's one of the best medical schools and researches in the country today. We have actually, in the last 10 years, we have actually produced over 400 patents in biotechnology, in Alzheimer's and medical research. But guess what? 50 are now being commercialized for consumers, for business. 8 in the state of New Mexico, 42 of the state. Colorado, Illinois, New Jersey. Why? Because we haven't invested in ourselves. We haven't invested in infrastructure. Again, we're continuously creating biotechnology companies every day and let them leave, creating hundreds of thousands of jobs for other states. We have become the greatest incubator of companies and jobs for Texas, Colorado, Arizona. So what if we invest in ourselves? Our hospitals, our medical schools. These are economic drivers for our rural communities. These are economic drivers for our cities. We lose millions of dollars every year to Colorado, Arizona, and Texas. Why? Because we will not invest into medical, into our hospitals, into urgent care centers. And we sit on $21.5 billion. These are economic drivers. We're short 200 doctors in our state, and everything I've read, We're short 1,500 nurses, and we're on our way to 3,200 nurses. And we haven't invested in our youth to prepare them for those jobs. In fact, you know what we do? We actually chase them out of the state. That's what we actually do. So we're going to change that. And if you give back to us, we'll give back to you. We're going to create a 7-year program for low debt financing, or you go and work where we need you, we'll pay for it. Whether you're a nurse, a teacher, or a doctor. Because guess what's going to happen after 7 years? You're going to be in your 20s. You're going to be cemented in that community. Your families are going to be cemented in that community. Right now, they pop in and out. Our doctors move. Our nurses move all the time. We need to invest in our kids. We need to invest in New Mexicans to do those jobs. Agriculture. Our first economy. We talked about it. And the reason apples are up there, here's a crazy figure. When my father was governor, New Mexico produced the third largest producers of apples in the country, in Espanol Town. Today, we produce less than 0.5% of the apples in the country, and our Espanol apple growers can't sell at Espanol High School. It's crazy. Hops is up there. Next to healthcare, the fastest growing industry in New Mexico are breweries. And they buy their hops from Colorado, Indiana, and Idaho. Guess what grows naturally up in northern New Mexico? Hops. Now, I don't know anything about beer, except I like drinking it. But 5 of those hops, we can actually brew beer. And I've talked to 6 brewmasters in this town that have said, if we had hops here, we'd buy New Mexicans. Now, guess what? Our political leaders don't know a word that we happen to use. I don't know if you guys have heard about it. There's a word that we use that our political leaders just don't understand. It's called export. We can grow our own hops here in northern New Mexico, create a hops co-op, invest in ourselves, invest in manufacturing and distribution, and create an industry that's exploding around the country. And we can get ahead of the curve. Now let's talk about cannabis and hemp, because it's going to be a topic. Hear what you say. Hemp is a no-brainer. We know the medical benefits, and it's a manufacturing opportunity. Did you know our constitution is written on hemp? Did you know our forefathers were hemp farmers? The third largest car seat producer in the world that uses hemp, is it in China? It's in Wattis, man. It's 4 hours away from us. It's down in Santa Teresa, the seventh largest land port in the country. So what if? Cannabis. It's going to be a topic. Some people are telling me not to talk about it. I'm going to talk about it. In fact, I'm the only candidate that says I will legalize it for adult users. But let me tell you why. I don't think people realize this. In 1978, my father, as governor, actually signed the Medical Marijuana Act, Research Act, into law. We were the first state to create medical marijuana. Never knowing 2 years later, his own son would use medical marijuana to get through cancer. I took pills, I took shots, medical shots. I took shots every day, every 3 hours. I took so many shots that you couldn't feel my right thigh. Alfred Santos played high school and college football with me. We were stupid college kids. We used to have punching contests in my leg to see if I could feel it. It took me 2 years to get the feeling back. I took so many shots, it took me 2 years. Well, guess what got me through chemotherapy? Medical marijuana. So we know the benefits. And folks, it's an opportunity. We can finally get ahead of the curve. Instead of being the followers, we've learned from Colorado. We've learned from Oregon. I'm telling you right now, it's 32,000 jobs for the state of New Mexico, over $200 million of tax revenue. Now, two things. Nevada started selling it in July. July 1st, they ran out in the first week.
They have a crisis.
And Colorado just announced they just made over $500 million in tax revenue today, they announced it.
Yep.
So what if? What if we invest in our strengths and ourselves and create opportunities for our kids and our future? Tourism. Between the Mexican culture, the Indian culture, and the Spanish culture, and yes, our outlaws. They're tourism. It's 10% of our economy. And we need to invest in our outside activities, fishing, hunting, tourism spots. Now, folks, let me tell you, this is simple. It's this simple. 73% of New Mexicans, they don't go to Hawaii. They don't go to Europe. Guess what they do? They get in a car and they drive their families 3 to 4 times a year on 3-day, 4-day weekends to San Antonio, Texas, to Austin, to Cobb, California, to Nevada. Now, we may never able ever to compete with California. Our kids are bugging us to go to Harry Potter. Our kids want us to go to San Diego to see their friends that have left the state and see the beach. But think about this. If we just invested in ourselves and kept half those families half the time here, that's $400 to $500 million more into our economy, into small businesses. So what if? Education. We talked about how we're going to turn our business plans around, our economy around. We need to invest in our education. Our education plan is 0 to 20. And we have to invest in early child development. Now, my father, in 1975, started a year-round kindergarten. And that was great. But guess what we've learned in 40 years? That we have to start earlier. We have twin boys that are 9. I saw how important it is to start earlier. 61% of our kids get no early child development, nor early preschool. That's going to change under an Apodaca administration. And we have to bring the families along and develop the families with them. Now, our kids are dropping out of high school at 46%. Some communities as high as 53, 56. We have cut so many programs out of our high schools and our middle schools that our kids are not staying engaged. Now, I was a jock, and I played sports. But sports is the love that took me to school. Sports is the love that kept me engaged. We have cut so many art programs, so many drama programs. We have cut so many programs that we don't keep our kids in school. In fact, we have cut our trade programs out of our schools. There are 41,000 jobs today, that go subcontracted out of state or go unfilled in the trade skills because we have stopped training our kids for those. I have a friend that builds engines for sprint cars. He learned that at Santa Fe High. Not at a trade school. And we're going to work with students and low-debt financing that if you get back to us, we'll get back to you. When we talk about our trade school, our union brothers and sisters have apprenticeship programs that we're not going to reinvent them. Let's just roll those into our high schools. We can roll our apprentices. I was at the carpenters. We can roll in their 4-year apprentice program starting as a sophomore. They can make money after school. By the time they graduate, they have a 1-year apprentice left. These are $60,000 to $75,000 a year jobs going to Texas, going to Colorado. Why? Because we don't invest in ourselves. So what if we do things a better way? What if we invest in ourselves? Where's that going to take us? 225,000 new jobs and $1.8 billion of new tax revenue annually for our state, for our schools, for our nurses, for our kids, for our police officers, our firefighters, our veterans. And it will also generate 200 more doctors in our state and 3,200 more nurses and everybody in our schools. We'll be taking home thousands of dollars more a year, not just our teachers. So what if? What will that do for us? Here it is, folks. Take a picture. I really want you to take a picture. Take a picture, post it, put it online, because I'm going to tell you right now, once we finish this Apple tour, our political leaders are going to start talking about this. Because here is our plan. Here is our investment. Here is the job creation for the state of New Mexico. This is it. but it'll also create higher wages. Now, I'm going to ask three beautiful women to stand up. Martha, Madonna, Clara. These three women right here. I have known these three women since I was born. These three women right here, since I've known them, has fought for equal pay for women. I have heard these three women my entire life fighting for equal pay. And folks, it is time we get equal pay for women and for all. About minimum wage. It's time we start talking about a living wage for men. And job training programs, we talked about it. Job training programs. Today, 35 and under, half the jobs today are telecommuting jobs. What does that mean? I had to explain that to Clara. They're not 8-to-5 jobs anymore. And I'm not talking about the future, I'm talking about today. Half the job today that 35 and under do. They work on a project-oriented-based jobs. They work for California companies, Arizona companies, Chicago, New York companies. The average pay is $83,000 a year. Our high school graduates, our kids can't get those jobs because we haven't trained them for those jobs. We haven't offered them those programs. And most of these jobs are coding programming jobs that we could literally teach in high school. But we don't do that. We're going to change that. Here's a story. I have a friend. They're like, let's help Grants. He literally went, started this training program, exactly what we're talking about, in Grants on his own. And he's going to graduate 10 kids a year. He just graduated 10 of them. Not one of them could get a job. Why? They don't have high-speed internet. They don't have co-working spaces. So my buddy grabbed another buddy, and they're now looking for a building in Grants, New Mexico, to create high-speed internet, thank you, and co-working spaces for these kids. Guys, it's about investing in our infrastructure. It's about investing in our opportunities. It's about getting our kids their opportunities to invest. That will also help the middle class. And look, it's time we start looking at family medical leave. Look, if conservative Arizona can work with their business community and their political leaders and the public and get it done, we can too. And we have to relook at our total tax plan, and we have to give tax relief for families with early child development. We have to. And let me tell you something. Our state needs to embrace the share economy. We need to embrace Uber. We need to embrace those type of opportunities. Those are extra opportunities and money for our middle class, for our communities. It's a must. So what if? What if we invest in ourselves? What if we invest in New Mexico? What if we invest in a guy who's never held political office? What if we invest in a guy that has just proven to you that we can generate 225,000 new jobs by investing in ourselves? You know my biggest thing that keeps me up at night? Is what if we don't win? Where will our state be in 10 years? Because our political leaders we're running against have not proven to me that they'll invest in New Mexico. So with your help, we can turn New Mexico around, and I'd like to open up for questions, and thank you guys for coming on. Questions.